Glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to our beloved Gurudev. My humble obeisances to all the assembled Vaishnavas. Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. I humbly offer my obeisances to all of you and I humbly request for your blessings that I may carry out the order of Guru Maharaj and speak something that may be helpful to all of us in our devotional life. Thank you very much for coming on the call. Please give me your blessings. So I would like to speak on verse from the Srimad Bhagavatam. It's from the fourth canto, chapter 12. Dhruva Maharaj goes back to Godhead. We will first speak on 37 by mercy of Guru and Krishna. There we go. Thank you so much, Lavanya.
So you want to go with the translation and purport too of 36, Mataji, or only just...
No, just we'll read translations and then we will read the purport of 37. Because they sort of go together. There's a flow there. Om Agyana Timirandasya Gnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam. So we will read 36, which goes like this. The self-effulgent Vaikuntha planets, by whose illumination alone all the illuminating planets within this material world give off reflected light, cannot be reached by those who are not merciful to other living entities. Only persons who constantly engage in welfare activities for other living entities can reach the Vaikuntha planets. Text 37. Persons who are peaceful, equipoised, cleansed, and purified, and who know the art of pleasing all other living entities, keep friendship only with devotees of the Lord. They alone can very easily achieve the perfection of going back home, back to Godhead. So we will speak on this one. I was inspired to speak about this verse because here Srila Prabhupada stresses the importance of our wonderful institution, our great organization ISKCON. And how to go back home. Both of these are very well illustrated in this beautiful verse, which goes like this. Shanta samadrishya shuddha sarva bhutanuranjanaha yanti anjasachutya padam achyuta priya bandavaha. So the translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Persons who are peaceful, equipoised, cleansed, and purified, and who know the art of pleasing all other living entities, keep friendship only with devotees of the Lord. They alone can very easily achieve the perfection of going back home, back to Godhead. Purport. The description of this verse fully indicates that only devotees Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskrityam Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Saraswatim Vyasam Tato Jayamudiraye Nashta Prayeshu Abhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavati Uttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki. So we will begin again with the translation and purport. Persons who are peaceful, equipoised, cleansed and purified, and who know the art of pleasing all other living entities, keep friendship only with devotees of the Lord. They alone can very easily achieve the perfection of going back home, back to Godhead. Purport. The description of this verse fully indicates that only devotees are eligible to enter into the kingdom of Godhead. The first point stated is that devotees are peaceful, for they have no demands for their personal sense gratification. They are simply dedicated to the service of the Lord. Karmis cannot be peaceful because they have immense demands for sense gratification. As for Jnanis, they cannot be peaceful because they are too busy trying to attain liberation or merge into the existence of the Supreme. Similarly, yogis are also restless to get mystic power. But a devotee is peaceful because he is fully surrendered to the Supreme Personality of Godhead and thinks of himself as completely helpless. Just as a child feels complete peace in depending on the parent, so a devotee is completely peaceful, for he depends on the mercy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. A devotee is equipoised. He sees everyone on the same transcendental platform. A devotee knows that although a conditioned soul has a particular type of body according to his past fruitive activities, factually, everyone is part of the Supreme Lord. A devotee sees all living entities with spiritual vision and does not discriminate on the platform of the bodily concept of life. Such qualities develop only in the association of devotees. Without the association of devotees, one cannot advance in Krishna consciousness. Therefore, we have established the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. Factually, whoever lives in this society automatically develops Krishna consciousness. Devotees are dear to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and the Supreme Personality of Godhead is only dear to devotees. On this platform only can one make progress in Krishna consciousness. Persons in Krishna consciousness or devotees of the Lord can please everyone, as is evident in the Krishna consciousness movement. We invite everyone without discrimination. We request everyone to sit down and chant the Hare Krishna mantra and take as much prasad as we can supply, and thus everyone is pleased with us. This is the qualification, Sarva Bhutanuranjanaha. As for purification, no one can be more pure than devotees. Anyone who once utters the name of Vishnu immediately becomes purified inside and outside. Yasmaret Pundarikaksham. Since a devotee constantly chants the Hare Krishna mantra, no contamination of the material world can touch him. He is therefore actually purified. Muchi hoy, shuchi hoy, yadi Krishna bhaje. It is said that even a cobbler or person born in the family of a cobbler can be elevated to the position of a brahmana, shuchi, if he takes to Krishna consciousness. Any person who is purely Krishna conscious and who engages in chanting the Hare Krishna mantra is the purest in the whole universe. Om Agyanatimirandasya Gnananjana Shalakya Chakshurum Militamina Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. So this is a very beautiful verse which actually teaches us what qualities we need to develop to go back home, back to Godhead, how to develop them, where to develop them, and how to execute the process of devotional service so that we can acquire these qualities. So this is a, you know, very illustrative verse about the goal, the aim, the process, and the requirements. For anything, let's say I want to become an engineer, let's just say. So what do I have to do? I have to qualify for that. I have to go through the preliminary schooling. Then I have to clear the various exams. Then I have to show my SAT score or GRE score or whatever it is they do nowadays. Then I have to write up a paper saying why I'm interested in a particular field. Then I have to appear for an interview before the faculty and explain to them why I want to become an engineer. So many things happen before we even get admitted into an engineering school or a medical school or an architecture school or whatever it is. And then we have to apply ourselves to the syllabus. We have to go through the process of study. We have to submit our paper, we have to do project work, we have to please the professors, and then we clear that particular year, like that, the next year, and the third year, and the fourth year, and the fifth year, and then finally you're a graduate. They say, yes, here's your degree. You're a graduate. And everyone wears that hat and wears the cape and stands in front of, you know, the symbol of that particular university and takes photographs. And now they say, yay, I'm an engineer. Isn't that what happens in you know, today's times? But we as devotees are trying to acquire a qualification of what? Going back home to Krishna in the spiritual world, which is where we actually belong. Because we understand that, you know, we are just playing roles. But our eternal identity is what? We are servants of Krishna and nothing but servants of Krishna. Ekale Ishwara Krishna Ara Sabhritya. What does that mean? There is only one Ishwara, Krishna, and everyone else is servant. So we have to qualify ourselves to become that pure, loving servant of Krishna. Then only we will be allowed entry. Supposing, say, just recently I was in Lavanya's house, you know, and there was this question, how to go to UK, how to get through, how to get the visa, how to, you know, manage it, and so on and so forth. So even to go from one country to another, there are so many restrictions, there's so many requirements, there's so many procedures, there's so many challenges. How we can think we can go back to the spiritual world without qualifying? That's not possible. So we have to qualify. And how do we do that? By understanding the process of devotional service as outlined by the great souls who have left the boat on this side for us to cross over the ocean of material existence. So let's go to the purport. What does it say? The first point is that devotees are peaceful. They have no demands for their personal sense gratification. They're simply dedicated to the service of the Lord. So you may say, oh, Mataji, I'm not there yet. And that's fine. We're all in the process of getting purified. Cheto darpana marjanam. But as long as we keep trying and we keep applying ourselves to this process, Krishna will help. Krishna says that, I will give you the intelligence how to come back to me. Tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yenamam upayantite. So what is the qualification? We have to become peaceful. So we have to eliminate this torment of material desires, which are always, you know, torturing us all the time. I want this, I want that, I need this, I need that. I have this expectation of this person, I have that expectation. We have so many material things fermenting, you know, like bubbles, you know, all the time, you know, coming up to the surface in one form or the other. But by engaging the process of devotional service, we can calm that fever, bring that feverish mentality down and become more and more peaceful and equipoised in the service of the Lord, understanding that all these are just waves, you know, like the coming and the going of the summer and the winter season, you know, things will come, things will go, but we remain equipoised. We don't get so affected. Matra sparshas tu kaunteya sitoshna sukha dukkada agama upayano nitya stam tikshis tam titikshasva bharata. What does that mean? O son of Kunti, the non-permanent appearance of happiness and distress are like the coming and the going of the summer and the winter seasons. They arise from sense perception, O son of Bharat, and one should learn to tolerate them without being disturbed. So devotee rises above all the happenings of this material world by coming to a higher and higher platform of functioning by moving more and more towards the spiritual energy and not allowing the material energy to keep pulling at us. Because the material modes, you know, we are like puppets in the hands of Maya. And if we allow her to control us, then we are bogged down in all the problems and the temptations and the allurements and then the reactions of giving into all those things. But we try to rise above all those things by engaging in this process of devotional service and become peaceful. They're simply dedicated to the service of the Lord. Now, karmis cannot be peaceful. Why? Because fruitive work, I must get something for what I'm doing. I must get a result and I must make a profit and I must impress people and I must come up in life and I must advance on the career ladder. And I'm, you know, so many musts and so many demands and so much longings, hankering, and then lamenting. Oh, I didn't get this position. Oh, I didn't get my girl. Oh, I didn't get admission to that car. Oh, I lost that job. Oh, so there's hankering, lamenting, hankering, lamenting. So karmis cannot be peaceful because they're caught up in trying to fulfill their desires, which is like the donkey and the carrot and the stick. It's always there hanging above the donkey's head, and the donkey thinks he's going to get it. Now with the next lunge, he's going to get it, but it doesn't happen. The carrot swings way back the other way. So karmis cannot be peaceful. Jnanis also cannot be peaceful because they are also doing everything with a motive, a personal motive. I have to gain liberation. I have to merge into the Brahman effulgence. I want to get out of material miseries. But they don't have a positive engagement of loving service to Krishna. So they are also restless. They are not peaceful. As for yogis, they want to control through mystic power. They want to acquire siddhis. They want to become, you know, powerful yogis. They want to manipulate the material energy. They want to do levitation. They want to impress people. They want to have a following. They want to show how powerful they are. So they cannot be peaceful either because they are trying to get something for themselves. But devotee is not like that. He is only trying for one thing, how to please Krishna. That is the only thing the devotee wants. So we are released from all this unnecessary entanglements simply because we have been given mercy of Srila Prabhupada. We are so blessed to come to the platform of devotional service because that is disentanglement from the material energy. And only one who is pure and only one who is free can unbind you. A bound person whose hands and legs are tied cannot free you. Only a person who's free can free you. And that is the spiritual master, the pure devotee of love. So a devotee is peaceful because what does he do? He's fully surrendered to the Supreme Personality of Godhead and thinks of himself as completely helpless. Just as a child feels complete peace in depending on the parent, devotee is completely peaceful, for he depends on the mercy of the Lord. Now, many of you are parents, isn't it? I just was in a wonderful devotee home with Lavanya and Srinivas and their two teenage children. And you should see how Lavanya dotes on her kids. She prepares different breakfasts and lunches and dinners and is making hot ginger tea for her kids when they have a sore throat. She's, you know, like Mother Yashoda, she's, you know, doting over her children, making sure they're so nicely taken care of. Why? Because they are dependent on her. So her child doesn't have to ask, mommy, 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 give me food, mommy, 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 take care of me, mommy. Mommy automatically does those things out of love, out of care, out of concern. So if we as just human mothers and fathers do so much for our kids, what can the Supreme Lord not do for his child, his devotee? You tell me that. Is there anything Krishna cannot do? He even came in the form of Narsingadev, half man, half lion, to tear apart Hiranyakashipu and to give pleasure to his little devotee Prahlad. So there's nothing that the Lord will not do to help his devotee. Nothing at all. He even became a chariot driver. You know, that's called a chauffeur. In today's terminology, chauffeur. But the Lord agreed to become a chariot driver out of love for his devotee Arjun, because Arjun was completely dependent on the Lord in that situation. He had no other recourse except the Lord's mercy. So a devotee is completely peaceful because he knows Krishna is there. There is nothing to worry. Sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam praja aham tvam sarva papibhyo mokshayishyami ma sujaha. Now you might say, oh, Mataji, I'm not so surrendered. I'm still, you know, doubtful. I'm still worried. What is this, you know, Hare Krishna movement? I see all these weird devotees. They're like, oh, I don't know, and this and that. And that's fine. We are in the process of surrendering. We are in the process of coming to understand what this great institution is about. We are in the process of understanding that everyone is at different points in their journey. Everyone is, you know, impacted differently by the modes of nature, but the process is pure and it is guaranteed to bring us back to Krishna. Why? Because a pure devotee of the Lord, Srila Prabhupada, has come to take us back to Godhead. And he promises, you will see Krishna face to face. So this is the process. And Krishna gives this reassurance that whoever thinks of me will come back to me. So Krishna is there and devotee is completely peaceful because he simply depends on the Lord for everything. So devotee becomes what? Equipoised. What is the meaning of equipoised? That means equal in any circumstance. No matter what is going on, devotee understands this is just the pushings of the material energy. I don't have to react. I don't have to get perturbed. I don't have to get disturbed. I simply take shelter of the Lord and depend on his mercy. Tattenu kampam su samikshamano bunjana evatma kritam vipakam ridva vapurbhir vidadan namaste jiveta yo mukti padesa daya bhak. Srimad Bhagavatam chapter canto 10. I don't remember the canto. It's the Brahma, Lord Brahma's prayers to 10, 14, 8. Yeah. 10th canto, 14th chapter, verse number 8. Brahma is saying in his prayers that whoever is completely devoted and taking shelter of you, they're going through so many difficulties, but because they're earnestly engaged in your devotional service, you're giving them all protection and they become eligible. 10, 14, 8. To go back to the kingdom of God. So let's take a look at that. Brahma's prayers to Lord Krishna. Yes, this is the verse we are talking about. My dear Lord, let's go to the translation a little below. One who earnestly waits for you to bestow your causeless mercy upon him, all the while patiently suffering the reactions of his past misdeeds, and offering you respectful obeisances with his heart, words, and body, is surely eligible for liberation, for it has become his rightful claim. See how much reassurance is there in this verse that we have to just be patient. We have to just prosecute this wonderful, sublime process of devotional service, and the Lord will take care of everything. Let's go back to the purport, please, the previous one. Right. So a devotee knows that although the conditioned soul has a particular type of body, according to his past fruitive activities, everyone is part and parcel of Krishna. Pandita Sama Darshinaha. What is that verse? Bhagavad Gita 5:18. Vidya Vinaya Sampanne Brahmani The learned and gentle Brahmanas, by virtue of true knowledge, see with equal vision a learned and gentle Brahmana, an elephant, a cow, a dog, and a dog eater. Why? Because they see the Supreme Lord as Paramatma in each and every body. The body is just the external covering, but the same soul and the super soul is there in every creature who is a child of God. So the devotee develops this vision that he sees all creation and all the bumblebee, the butterfly, the ant, the grasshopper, the black neighbor, the Vietnamese neighbor, the Korean neighbor, the Japanese neighbor, they're all different bodies, but they're all children of the same Krishna and Radha. So devotee develops equal vision and does not discriminate after that point. That's actually a very beautiful purport. Can we go to that purport, please, Lavanya? Bhagavad Gita 5:18 is really very important because developing this equal vision, especially as devotees, for us to understand how important it is for us, at least as devotees, to not discriminate based on the body. Today, there's such a problem, racism and speciesism and genderism and ageism and thisism and thatism, and you know, people distinguish on the platform of position and age and sex and gender and nationality and so on. But devotees are not like that. Let's read this purport. It's very beautiful. A Krishna conscious person does not take any distinction between species or caste. The Brahmana and outcast may be different from the social point of view, or a dog, a cow, an elephant may be different from point of view of species, but these differences of body are meaningless from the viewpoint of a learned transcendentalist. This is due to their relationship to the Supreme. For the Supreme Lord, by his plenary portion as Paramatma, is present in everyone's heart. Such an understanding of the Supreme is real knowledge. As far as bodies are concerned in different castes or different species, the Lord is equally kind to everyone because he treats every living being as a friend, yet maintains himself as Paramatma. The Lord as Paramatma is present both in outcaste and in the Brahmana. All these bodies are different modes of material nature, but the soul and super soul are of the same spiritual quality. The similarity in the quality of the soul and the super soul, however, does not make them equal, for the individual soul is present only in that particular body, whereas Paramatma is present in each and every body. A Krishna conscious person has full knowledge of this, and therefore he is truly learned and has equal vision. The similar characteristics of the soul and super soul are that they are both conscious, eternal, and blissful. Okay, that's what I wanted to say of this. So let's go back to the purport, please. Thank you. So how to develop this equal vision? This happens in the International Society of Krishna Consciousness. This is where we learn Pandita Samadarshinaha. A devotee sees all living entities with spiritual vision and does not discriminate on the platform of the bodily concept of life. Such qualities develop only in the association of devotees. Without the association of devotees, one cannot make advancement in Krishna consciousness. Therefore, we have established the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. Whoever lives in this society automatically develops Krishna consciousness. Devotees are very dear to the Lord, very dear to the Lord. And the Lord is also very dear to the devotees. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, I envy no one, nor am I partial to anyone. But whoever renders loving service unto me is a friend, is in me, and I am also a friend to him. The devotees know nothing but Krishna, and Krishna knows nothing but his devotees. Verse number 929 in Bhagavad Gita. Can we just take a quick look at that? That's a very beautiful verse. We feel so reassured by reading this verse. Krishna is there. Krishna is mine. He's there for me. And he'll always be there for me. We get so much reassurance from this particular verse. It is 929. Samoham sarve bhuteshu name dveshosti nya priyaha ye bhajanti tu mam bhaktya mai te teshu chapyaham. I envy no one, nor am I partial to anyone. I am equal to all. But whoever renders service unto me in devotion is a friend, is in me, and I am also a friend to him. So Krishna takes very special care. See this sentence. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But for his devotees, he gives specific attention. Isn't that wonderful? Krishna is taking a special interest in you, my dear spirit soul, my dear brothers and sisters. Why? Because he loves his devotees. He loves his obedient children who have finally recognized the truth that we are only servants of Krishna. We have gotten out of this conception that I am the Lord of all I serve. We are not trying to bully and dominate other people. We are trying to become humble servants of Krishna. So Krishna takes great pleasure in a person who has surrendered like this and is wanting to come back to him. Such devotees are mentioned here. They're always in Krishna consciousness, and therefore they're always transcendentally situated in Krishna. So Krishna says this, the thoughts of my pure devotees dwell in me. Their lives are devoted to my service, and they take great delight. In always enlightening one another and conversing about me. They derive great satisfaction and bliss. Yeah, that's the actual translation. That's Tushyanti Cha Ramanti Cha verse. That's in Bhagavad Gita 10:9. And Krishna is reassuring us that this is the way to come back to me. Just think of me, become my devotee, engage yourself in serving me, and you will come back to me. The thoughts of my pure devotees dwell in me. Their lives are fully devoted to my service. They derive great satisfaction and bliss from always enlightening one another and conversing about me. So this is where Krishna is, in the Association of Devotees, in the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. And Krishna says this, I decide where my devotees are singing my glories. This is where I am. So we want more Krishna Katha, isn't it? We want Tushyanti cha, Ramanti cha, great satisfaction and bliss by talking about Krishna, singing Krishna's glories, worshipping Krishna, praising Krishna, doing everything for Krishna. It's only Krishna all the way. Krishna, 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 Krishna. Who else is there? Okay, let's go back to the purport, please. Therefore, we have established the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. Devotees are dear to the Supreme Lord, and the Supreme Lord is only dear to the devotees. On this platform only can one make progress in Krishna consciousness. So, devotees who reach this point of being equipoised, peaceful, seeing everyone with equal vision, friendly to all living entities, always wanting to be of service, they can purify themselves more, 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 and go back home to Krishna. So we want to reach this point. We want to establish ourselves nicely, become fixed in devotional service so that we can keep making progress in our path back home, back to Krishna. So Srila Prabhupada explained, what is this International Society for Krishna Consciousness doing? It is showing the way back home. We invite everyone, all our temples, all over the world, everyone is welcome to take prasadam. Take prasadam, take as much as you want, isn't it? When you go for any Sunday feast, what did the devotees say to the guests? Eat, 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 eat. Srila Prabhupada says, eat up to the neck. So devotees are so lavish. Devotees are so generous. Devotees are so kind-hearted, so compassionate. And they're wanting to give the mercy in the form of prasadam, in the form of their loving selves, in the form of the holy name, in the form of sankirtan. In so many ways, devotees are spreading the mercy of the Lord. So who can be more merciful than devotee, and who can do greater benedictory work for the whole world other than devotee? So this is the qualification. Sarva bhuta nuranjanaha. Let's go back to the translation of this particular word in the translation, please. See how beautifully this is explained. Anuranjanaha means pleasing. Bhuta means living entities. Sarva means all. So devotees become pleasing to all living entities. The Sadhu Goswamis, they were pleasing to the gentle. They were pleasing to the ruffians also. Everyone was charmed by their humility, by their kindness, by their compassion, by their being equipoised, by their being humble and tolerant, and serving the Lord through all circumstances. So we want to become like that by hearing about the great souls. We want to acquire these qualifications. Okay, Sarva Bhuta Nuranjanaha. You want to become like that. Let's go down and complete that purport, and then we can open up for questions. As for purification, no one can be more pure than devotees. Anyone who once utters the name of Vishnu immediately becomes purified. Lord Chaitanya was asked, who is a Vaishnav? And he said, anyone who utters the name of Krishna once, he is a Vaishnav. So how merciful the Lord is being in this incarnation. He's so magnanimous. He's so merciful. He's so compassionate that if you just utter the name Krishna once, you're a Vaishnav. So that is why devotees go around telling everybody, please, can you read what's on this card? Can you tell me what is this? Oh, what is this? Krishna. There, they've said the name Krishna. Devotee is happy. So simply by taking the name of Krishna, you become purified. And devotee wants to therefore constantly be chanting, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So we want to be constantly reaching that point of constant chanting, because that's actually the nature of the soul. The soul is chanting Hare Krishna 24 hours. In the spiritual world, the Hare Krishna Mahamantra is going on all the time, without stop. So we want to reach Satatam Yukta, Satatam Kirtayantu Mam, always chanting my glories. So no contamination can touch a person who's constantly chanting the name of Krishna, who's glorifying Krishna. And even a cobbler can become purified and come to the highest stage of perfection of life in Krishna consciousness if he or she sincerely and seriously and diligently and patiently and with great determination and enthusiasm applies himself or herself to this process of bhakti yoga, he or she can attain the highest perfection, which is what? To become situated in your original position, pure loving servant of Krishna. Any person who is purely Krishna conscious, who engages in chanting Hare Krishna mantra, is the purest in the whole universe. So we do want to come to this point of being perfectly pure, free of all material contamination, completely, totally immersed in loving service to Krishna, and go back home to be with Krishna. Isn't it? That's why we have this International Society for Krishna Consciousness to teach us all these things that are required to go back home, back to Krishna. So thank you all very much for listening very, very patiently. It would be lovely to see everyone, my dear God family. I can only humbly request you to show your beautiful selves, if you like, by Hari Bol, Ashutosh Prabhu, Deepti,
my humble opinion. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. All of
you. How are you?
Very good. Coming up for initiation. You must be so excited.
Yes. This is a little bit pending still, but hopefully soon. Pray for me, please.
Oh, of course. Of course. Welcome. Welcome to the family.
Thank you.
And Namrata is there. I see Namrata. And Sudha Mataji and Madhavananda Prabhu, Vishwapavini, Samyadati, Madan Gopal, Vishnupriya. My humble will open up for questions, comments, realizations, corrections.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna Namrata, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Prabhupada, all glories to Gurudev.
It was a wonderful class, Mataji. I definitely appreciate your quality of the flawless speech you give. I always wonder. So that is one of the quality I see in you, the flawless Krishna conscious speech that you carry out. Can you hear me, Mataji?
Yeah, I can hear you, but I'm really wondering where the flawlessness when I'm making so many mistakes. So I'm thinking you must be a very kind and compassionate Vaishnavi to overlook all the flaws and then still say it is flawless. Your kindness is
nice hearing you, you know. Because even when I try to speak out anything over Krishna consciousness, the hundreds of thoughts come out of my mind. I get so conscious. Whatever I'm speaking, is it, I be conscious that I'm not, you know, concocting or telling something out of my own thinking. I'm referring to Prabhupada. I'm referring to what Maharaj has said. I'm referring to what I have read. So there is that consciousness, you know, when I try to speak. So yeah. You are quite confident in that. So I really appreciate that thing.
Let me just explain that a little bit. When I was a beginner, when I came to Krishna consciousness, this was 2001, 2002. I remember sitting there in front of Guru Maharaj and saying, I don't know anything. And then Guru Maharaj wrote to me and he says, whatever you know, you speak. And you know, you learn the art of preaching by preaching. That means you learn from your mistakes. You learn from practicing it. You learn from doing it. And he actually instructed me. This is an instruction from him. So I had to do it. He said, give class. So because the spiritual master tells you to do something and then you do it, the empowerment is there in the instruction. The empowerment comes from the guru. So we can pray, definitely. We can also write to our Guru Maharaj and say, you know, I would like to serve. Please tell me. And then when you follow the spiritual master's instructions, the empowerment comes from Krishna. So we all make mistakes and we all, I'm sure, you know, in 20 years, who knows how many mistakes I must have made by now, but somehow Krishna is mercifully still allowing me to do service and being of some use to devotees. So we are all in the, you know, process of trying to perfect ourselves and get better. But thank you very much. I don't want to be ungracious. Thank you for encouraging me in my service. It's very inspiring for me to see that one Vaishnavi is pleased with whatever I have said. So thank you so much.
Yes, I feel like, you are sitting like, you know, when we have a class, the lower KGs class, the children, the 5 years, 6 years old children, they're sitting and listening to the to their gurus and to their teachers. So the way you explain to us, isn't it like that? Like you are explaining that Krishna conscious, you know, thoughts and purpose in that way. So yeah, when you were preaching, so I could relate that. So as if we are like small children and we are listening to you.
I'm also a small child and I'm listening to Guru Maharaj.
Okay, Mataji, so I have a question. My question is, I want to understand what is the difference between liberation and going to the spiritual adobe? Because many times I have seen in the purports also and in many speeches also, sometimes liberation is just leaving, I mean, just realizing that you are not the body and you are the soul. And you're getting out of the concept of this bodily and material existence. And sometimes it's referring to, you know, the state where you go to Vaikuntha or the spiritual adopts.
Right. So liberation is like an escape. I want to escape this world, so I want to annihilate, you know, all this material existence, material miseries. I want to merge into the impersonal Brahman effulgence, and that way I will give up all the material concept of life, the material miseries. And so the jnanis, they aim for that because they want to negate all this. This concept of individuality becomes too much because the miseries are too much. And so they aim for liberation, which is just merging into the Brahman effulgence. But there is no positive engagement. There is no relationship with the Supreme Lord. There's no seva and sevak and sevaya, as we say. There is no process of positive engagement to the Supreme Lord. So after some time, it's like being in a vast space where you're the only person alone. And so because there is no engagement for the soul, they fall down again into the material world. You know, I heard Bhakti Charu Maharaj explaining it this way. You're in prison, okay? And then you dig a tunnel as a convict and you escape. You have escaped in one sense, but always that tension is there. They'll catch me, they'll catch me, they'll put me back because you have not really gotten free. While if they open all the prison doors and they say, you're a free man, walk out. You are totally free. Nobody is after you. So going back to Krishna is like that. Nobody can capture you and put you back. Once you're with Krishna, you're with Krishna. But the convict is always in doubt. Who will catch me? Who will discover that I have escaped and put me back there? I don't know whether that gives you an idea of the difference between what is that escape and what is actual liberation, what is actually going back to Krishna.
Okay, so basically after the liberation stage, we still have many bifurcations to go at many places, to many other destinations we have.
But yes, I think generally they fall down. They come back again to this material world because there is no engagement. There is no question of making progress from there to the spiritual world because they haven't got the first point right. You see, even if you are engaged a little bit in devotional service, you can pick it up again in your next life. Or you can keep building on it. So at least you're on the right road. But those who are on the point of reaching the Brahman effulgence, right from get-go, their goal is different. It's not the goal which will take them back to Krishna. So it's very difficult for them to go from that point to Krishna. They have to come back again to the material world, hopefully get the mercy of a pure devotee and begin the process of devotional service. And that's the only way to go back to Krishna.
The purport which he was, the prayers of Brahma, which we were referring recently, in that also, I saw the word
liberation. It's a good point. There, the word liberation is in a different sense. There, it is the actual freedom of going back to Krishna. So in the scriptures, the word liberation is used in different ways, in different contexts. So we have to see the context also in which that is explained. Then there's also the five different kinds of liberation. Samipya, Sarupya, Salokya, Sashti. What I'm describing is Sashti. That means merging into the Brahman effulgence. So, a devotee who desires to have the same form as the Lord, desires to be in the same abode as the Lord. All these are, again, personal desires. And that is also described as liberation. Samipya, Salokya, Sarupya, Sashti, and what is the fifth one? I forget. But, you have...
Sayujya.
Sayujya, thank you. Sayujya. So, liberation has different meanings in different contexts. So we have to understand it in the context in which that word is being used.
Okay, I was just recently going through one verse. I think it is Canto 1, Chapter 13 and verse 59, in which Prabhupada mentions it is a Vidura saying that Vidura was astonished to see his brother Dhritarashtra leaving as a liberated yogi. And in the same purport, he says that Dhritarashtra only attained liberation after many such liberated life, one attains liberation. One attains devotional service.
Can we go to that verse? Because I would like to actually see it before commenting, if you don't mind. Lavanya, can you tell the verse for us?
Can you tell the verse number again, Mataji?
It's 1:13:59.
Okay.
Yeah, in the purport, I think it's the first line itself where Vidura is saying, Vidura was astonished to see the marvelous departure of his brother Dhritarashtra as a liberated yogi. For in his past life, he was much attached to materialism. And I think ultimately in this same purport.
Mm-hmm. Therefore, Dhritarashtra attained liberation only. And after many such liberated states of life, one can attain to the stage of devotional service. Vidura was certainly very mortified by the death of his brother and sister-in-law, and the only remedy to mitigate such lamentation was to go out to pilgrimage. Yes, that is true. You may go up and down many times, you know. You may have many, many births. In fact, Krishna says, Bahunam janmanam ante jnanavan mam prapadyate vasudeva sarvam itisa mahatma sudurlabha. So we may reach many points on the ferris wheel. We can even go up to the stage of Brahma, then come back down as an ant. We may even, you know, go and merge into the Brahman effulgence, again come down to the material world. So there are so many ways we can try, you know, to get out of the material energy. And our desires will keep taking us to different destinations. And many times our desires may not be pure. And so we will have to take birth again at whatever point we have reached on that journey and come back again to the material world. Or from the Brahman effulgence, come back to this point. Or if we have made some progress in devotional life, then we will pick up at that point. But if there is a vast amount of desire for liberation, that means merging into the Brahman effulgence, if my desires for that are very prominent, I will still go there. But because I have done that devotional service, when I fall down, I will again pick up from where I left off. So we might have many ups and downs. This is my understanding. But what I would suggest is speak to Guru Maharaj. He will give you the explanation which will completely satisfy your heart. Because I can only speak from my level of understanding and realization, which is not much. So it's always best to take it to Guru Maharaj. Is that okay?
Okay, sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for asking such nice, deep questions. Anyone else would like to say anything or ask something?
Mataji, even I am pleased with your class.
Oh, thank you. We aim to please the Vaishnavas. That is the only way to please Krishna, to please the Vaishnavas. So thank you very much for saying that. It is very heartwarming for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Mataji. Here, Srinivas Prabhu is also saying.
Me too, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, my dear brother. You know, we have Srinivas Prabhu's birthday coming up, August 6th.
Oh, Mataji.
And, no. Yeah, I remember. And August 4th is Siddharth's birthday.
We have
our godbrother's birthday coming up very soon.
Give me all the blessings not to take birth again, Mataji.
Yes. I don't know about the blessings part. I don't know that I can give blessings, but I will certainly pray for you.
So, Mataji, I have a question. Here, as per the purport, they are saying that Prabhupada is saying that devotees are equipoised. But we feel that we are also every time in the anxiety, like doing services or any other thing, whatever devotional service we are doing, we are not in that stage. So can you tell me, like, what will be that stage? I don't know about that stage. Like, I think as an example, like Guru Maharaj will be the best example for that position, for that state. Equipoised. So is that what I am thinking, Mataji?
Yes. As we advance more and more and more in devotional service, we will be able to overcome our own personal fears and insecurities and worries and anxieties and become more and more equipoised. As if you hear the memory state, you know, Srila Prabhupada was a whirlwind of activity. But he was completely calm. He was running a whole organization across the globe. He was writing to so many people. He was opening so many temples. He was traveling to so many places. He was writing so many books. He was initiating so many people. He was meeting so many guests. He was doing so much. Can you imagine that high level of functioning? He was a whirlwind of activity, but he was completely calm because he knew everything depends on Krishna. He was completely dependent on Krishna. So So we want to become more and more situated in the Krishna consciousness so that we no longer allow the material modes of anxiety, nervousness, self-consciousness, and this thing and that thing to attack us. We surrender more and more to Krishna and we beg for his mercy to be able to carry out all our services nicely. Then we feel a sort of peace that we are not in control. You know, we are not the doers. We have to be very clear about that. Krishna is doing, allowing me to do this service. So whatever is happening by his mercy through me. I'm simply like a pipeline and Krishna is doing everything. So when we overcome this feeling that I've got to do this, I have to do I, and make it Krishna, 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 and less I, then we just release control and worry and anxiety and we just surrender and then, you know, we don't have so much fears and worries. I don't know if that's helpful.
Yeah, that's true, Mataji. When we think that, as you said, like I am doing all that, so we'll be in anxiety. If we think that Krishna is arranging everything, Krishna's work, he'll do, or he'll give us the solution if nothing is working. So then definitely we'll be in peace and handle the situation easily and positively.
Exactly. That is absolutely correct. For this, we have to have very strong sadhana.
Yes.
We have to keep our sadhana very strong. First thing in the morning, wake up early morning, really pray the Gurvashtakam prayers, begging for the mercy of the spiritual master to guide us and lead us. And that gives all intelligence for the day, actually.
Mm.
That is the armor we put on to protect ourselves from Maya's attacks.
Yes, Mataji.
Early morning rounds is actually the key to everything. Our spiritual life rests on that.
Yes, Mataji. Thank you so much.
Welcome. Thank you.
Yeah, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So it's almost 11 o'clock now, Mataji. And Sudha Mataji, you want to ask any question?
Yeah, Hare Krishna. Thank you, Mataji, Lavanya Mataji. Hare Krishna, Mataji, thank you for the very nice class. Glories to Srila Prabhupada, glories to Guru Maharaj, glories to you, Mataji. You just have, like, you have mentioned, like, about restlessness and happiness. So while performing devotional service also, we experience these things like restlessness, unhappiness, anxiety, because we couldn't execute it properly. So how should we handle these things, Mataji?
That's natural, you know. We are just learning how to be devotees. We are just learning the process of devotional service. We are like naughty children in class, you know. If you go to a KG class, kindergarten, the children, how they are running all over the place, jumping out of their seats, you know, banging on the desk and so on and so forth. But as you go through the older and older classes, you see the children have become quieter and quieter because they know now that they have to sit still, they have to pay attention, they have to focus on what teacher is saying, isn't it?
Yes.
Small children, and then you see little older children, you see, you go from one classroom to another, you see the difference.
Mm-hmm.
So we are like those little restless kids still, you know? And Srila Prabhupada says this in a letter, he says this, you know, you're like an infant. It is very natural that you will stumble and fall, but don't give up. Go on. And one day you will be walking, you will be running.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Mataji. Very nice. So as far as we have desire and we are practicing, it's okay, you said, like, because more worried about like offenses, okay, like, okay, I should not commit any offenses. So instead of thinking like that, as you have to just keep practicing, then eventually you will, yeah.
Eventually practice makes one perfect. And you may keep thinking, oh, I mustn't make offenses, but you will make offenses. I mean, we all do, you know, we will make mistakes, we will do things wrong, you know, that's just, we actually learn from our mistakes, to be honest. There's no need to be so careful that I will never make a mistake in Krishna consciousness. That's unrealistic, actually. It's not possible. Supposing you tell a little 4-year-old child, You will write a perfect A, B, C, D from day one in kindergarten. Is it possible?
No, Mataji.
They're going to make scrawls and they're going to make mistakes. And then slowly as their hand gets steady, then the A and the B and the C comes out nicely. So by repeatedly writing, we make them go through the cursive writing book. How many times they have to write A? 15,000 times before they get it right. We all, isn't it? So since in Krishna consciousness, practice, practice, practice. Practice makes one perfect. So we have to keep practicing with enthusiasm, with determination, with patience, and with faith that this will help us advance in Krishna consciousness.
Yes, Mataji. Yeah, thank you, Mataji. Thank you. As you said, like you know, I was when you think about too much of offenses, you'll end up committing offenses. So I see that happening with me. Yeah. Thank you so much, Mataji, for the beautiful answer. Hare Krishna. Dandavat Pranam.
Thank you. And Dandavat Pranam to you.
Thank you, Mataji.
Okay. So
I think finished. I think, yes, Mataji. No more questions, I think.
Thank you all very much. My humble obeisances to the Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis.
Mancha Kalpatari Krishna
Kripa. Hare
Krishna. Thank you.
Congratulations, Deepthi Mataji. We'll join online and see the event ceremony.
Mataji, it's not happening tomorrow, sorry. It's just a little bit of delay in the paperwork, putting it through. It was my fault. Little late. So hopefully in the near future, but I will definitely let you know.